awesome sermon. But anyhow, verse 32, Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, from now on, give us this bread. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me, and still you do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that he has given me, but raise them up at that last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him will have eternal life, and I will raise him up at that last day. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we do thank you so much that when we see on some of the tombs R.A.P., people think of resting in peace. But Lord, I always think of residing in paradise. But Lord, on that last day, you are going to raise us up, and we will dwell with you because we have that eternal life, because you are that bread of life that fills us day by day. I ask that you would be with us today as we learn from your word, as we hear from the Holy Spirit. Thank you so much for giving your son to die on the cross for our sins. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Oh, this morning we do come to celebrate and worship the Lord in Holy Communion. Jesus, the night he was betrayed, took the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "This bread is my body, which is broken for you." He took the cup and told them, "This represents my blood. This is my blood, which is going to be shed for you." And in explaining that, Jesus was giving them instructions, or Jesus was giving them an explanation of everything that was going to happen when he went to the cross. Our theme for Vacation Bible School was anchored, deepening our faith. And in the afternoon, I was had the task of explaining the cross to children. That's not an easy thing to do. And in the lesson plan, was to use the hymn, "The Old Rugged Cross," because that was one of the songs we had the kids sing, "The Old Rugged Cross." And I thought this morning, better than what I did yesterday, because I really didn't use the hymn in explaining the cross yesterday, because it was supposed to be a Bible story, and I didn't feel like it was honest to say this is a Bible story and to talk about a hymn. And so I read the scripture and talked about Jesus on the cross. But this morning I've shared the scripture. Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took the bread. Then he took the cup. Listen to the words of the song, "The Old Rugged Cross," by George Bernard. "On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. Whose suffering and whose shame? Well, certainly Jesus suffered on the cross. Jesus bore a lot of shame. I explained to the kids yesterday as they read the scripture that not only was Jesus nailed to the cross and lifted up, but then the soldiers gambled for his clothing. I didn't go into a lot of detail, but understand that the Bible makes it clear that when Jesus died on the cross, he was without clothing. Say that Jesus hung there naked. Artists like to put a towel around him or put a, you know, his underpants on. That's not what the Bible says. And so when Jesus hung on the cross, not only had he suffered physically, but there was shame. But the suffering and the shame that Jesus suffered was he suffered for you and for me. So when it talks about the emblem of suffering and shame, it's the emblem of the suffering and shame that we deserve. And so I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. The old rugged cross, despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for the dear Lamb of God. John the Baptist, when he saw Jesus, said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." He left his glory above to go to Calvary. There's a wondrous beauty I see. For on that cross, Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. That's why Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. My blood that is shed for you." So that we might be forgiven, we can be pardoned. But not only pardoned, pardoned and sanctified. You see, it's through the cross. Through the substitutionary death on the cross for you and for me, not only do we have our sins forgiven, but we are sanctified. We are cleansed and made holy and given the opportunity to be walked You know the chorus. Y'all have been around long enough, you know the words of this chorus without it being on the screen or in your book. Let's just sing the chorus. So I'll cherish the old rotting cross. So that we might have life, our sins might be forgiven, and we might have eternal life, a relationship with you that is real and personal, that we receive in this world and extends on into the next. So, Father, we ask your blessing upon the bread and the cup that's been prepared. We ask, Father, your blessing upon us as we partake of it this morning, that we will cherish and remember. Sacrifice of Jesus on the cross for us. And it's in his name, the only name through which we can come before your presence. We ask this. Amen. Well, we're going to, one more month, we're going to ask Jenny to have you come up and have a couple elders come up this morning and receive the bread and the cup this morning. We will worship. full and free would be fully manifested in us. And that, Father, that sanctifying power, the blood of Christ, would renew us and transform us and continually cause us to be more and more like Jesus every day. It would give you the praise and the honor and the glory for all that you accomplish and all that you do. In Jesus' name. Now, we used this yesterday in Vacation Bible School as a backdrop when we weren't doing anything else. So, don't pay more attention to the fishies than you do to me this morning. My wife kept saying, we have that tropical fish kind of theme going. We ought to have something on the screen to go along with that. So. You can do this at home, just on your TV screen, you connect your computer to it and bring up the fish video, and you don't have to have an aquarium and all that problem, just watch the fish. Actually, I think this morning, I'm just going to... be a little more informal. Now, fallen is a label that no Christian pastor or leader or evangelist wants associated with their name. I know I don't. Pastors and evangelists who have fallen into sin and disgrace make all kind of excuses. You know, hear them say, well, technically it wasn't illegal. Or they'll say, well, it was a youthful mistake. Or it was a conspiracy that was orchestrated by jealous church members. Well, all kinds of excuses. But there's really no excuse for religious authorities to preach one standard for their followers and then flaunt those rules in their own personal lives. There's no excuse for saying one thing and doing another. And you think back over the last decade, or more than decade, the last generation. Let's make it a generational thing. Think about you're trying to take the echo out. Little button there where it says 6, turn it to 2. Yeah, you should see on the right side where it says 6. If you adjust that to 2, it should take it out. All right. We think back over the last... it's still got an echo. Oh, well. You think back over the last decade. I just run a couple names by you. I'm not going to spend a lot of time, but you go back to Ted Haggard, who was an evangelical pastor back in the 2000s, early 2000s. He was caught up in a gay sex scandal. He was really big on Christian television. You go all the way back to 1987, you know a guy by the name of Jim Baker. Actually, you can see him again on Christian television. But he was brought down by an enormous scandal that included sexual abuse and fraud and all kinds of things. This one surprised me, and I kind of remembered it, but back in 2014, Remember a guy by the name of Bill Gothard and his institutes kind of thing? In 2014, more than 30 women accused Bill Gothard of molestation and assault, including underage girls. He lost his ministry. Another one back in the 80s, Jimmy Swaggart, cheating on his wife with a prostitute, avid consumer of fraud. Well, he's back on TV too. His ministry is greatly diminished, but he's still around. And then the one that broke a lot of people's hearts last year, in the Christian Missionary Alliance especially, Ravi Zacharias. Last year, 2020, after his death, there was an in-depth investigation of RZIM, his ministry, and the Christian Missionary Alliance. And it revealed that Ravi Zacharias had been involved in a lot of sexual misconduct, abuse, rape, even human trafficking. And you look at all those guys, you look at all their ministries, and there's some common elements that brought down these men and their ministries. One of the biggest common elements is success. They had a lot of success, not only in the eyes of Christians, but in the eyes of the world. They were popular. And as they gained popularity, they had a lot of people that became their personal followers that believed they could do nothing wrong. And after that success, there was that pride where they all felt they were above accountability. They didn't have to answer to anybody. That was Ravi Zacharias' problem. He felt like he was better than everybody. Nobody could question him at RZIM. They were controlling people because they were covering sin. They had to control everything. And so they were manipulative and controlling people. But all of that made them vulnerable to the deception of the enemy, seeking to destroy them and destroy the work that they were doing. And, you know, we can rehearse these names and remember their ministry and their fallenness, and we can pick up a lot of stones to throw at them, but understand that they're not the exception. That fallenness is not only those that are high profile leaders, but extends all the way down to all of us in the church. What was true for them is also true for each one of us. And so we need to be careful. The Apostle Paul's experience in Lystra in Acts chapter 14. So open your Bibles to Acts chapter 14. Paul's experience there in Lystra in Acts chapter 14 really teaches us how to handle success when you're on mission with Jesus Christ. This is still part of Paul's first missions trip. Back in Acts chapter 13, they traveled across the island of Cyprus and ministered there. Acts chapter 13, verse 44, they proclaimed the gospel in Pisidian Antioch and then got run out of that town. Then they traveled to Iconium and got Paul preached the gospel there. And verse 3, Acts chapter 14 and verse 3, it tells us that the ministry there in Iconium was a very positive ministry. It says, so Paul and Barnabas spent considerable time there speaking boldly for the Lord, who confirmed the message of his grace by enabling them to do miraculous signs and wonders. That's a very positive ministry. But then in verse 6, again, they had to run for their lives because they faced opposition. And so they ran for their lives to Lystra and then to Derbe. And again, he gets to Lystra and Paul speaks boldly for the Lord. And not only speaks boldly for the Lord, but there he performs a miraculous sign and wonder. Paul's response to the crowd in Lystra is really one of those examples for each one of us to follow. So let's begin in verse 8. In Lystra, There sat a man crippled in his feet, who was lame from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul as he was speaking. Paul looked directly at him, saw that he had faith to be healed, and called out, "Stand on your feet." At that, the man jumped up and began to walk. When the crowd saw what Paul had done, they shouted in the Lycaonian language, "The gods have come down to us in human form." Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul they called Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. The priest of Zeus, whose temple was just outside the city, brought bulls and wreaths to the city gates, because he and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifices to them. But when the apostles, Barnabas and Paul, heard of this, they tore their clothes and rushed out into the crowd, shouting, "Men, why are you doing this? We too are only men, human like you. We are bringing you good news, telling you to turn from these worthless things to the living God, who made heaven and earth and the sea and everything in them. In the past, he let all nations go their own way, yet he has not left himself without testimony. He has shown kindness in giving you rain from heaven and crops in their seasons. He prospers you with plenty of food and fills your hearts with joy." Even with these words, they had difficulty keeping the crowd from sacrificing to them. Then some Jews came from Antioch and Iconium and won the crowd over. They stoned Paul and dragged him outside the city, thinking he was dead. But after the disciples had gathered around him, he got up and went back to the city. The next day, he and Barnabas left for Derbe. Quite a ministry. Quite an experience there. And again, Paul spoke boldly for the Lord. And as I said, his whole experience here is really an example for us to follow, especially as in their response. How to deal with, call it success, if you're on mission for the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's look first of all, and you have an outline there on the back of your bulletin, the healing of the lame man. The healing of the lame man, that's in verses 8 through 10. Now notice it says that Paul was speaking. He listened, it says in verse 9, to Paul as he was speaking. And so A there is Paul spoke. And the word for speaking there can mean just ordinary conversation, but it can also mean formal speaking. And so the picture is that Paul was speaking probably in the marketplace, maybe conversing with a group of people. It's not like he was standing on a podium in the middle of an auditorium and preaching. He may have been standing in the marketplace using a loud voice and proclaiming Jesus. But whatever way, Paul spoke boldly about Jesus Christ. And as he was doing that, this man who had been lame from birth heard what Paul was saying. Paul was explaining the gospel, speaking boldly. And now this man was, it says, lame from birth. And he overheard what Paul's speaking. Now it's interesting, both Peter and Paul, in the beginning of their ministries, had an encounter with a man who was lame from birth. That's back in Acts chapter 3, where Peter and John was going up into the temple to pray, encountered a man that was lame from birth. Here, Paul, on his first missionary journey, encounters a man who was lame from birth. Well, why is that significant? Well, it's important to know, because for this man to get up and walk would obviously have been a miracle. He had been lame from birth. There was no other medical reason that he had a fall or he had some kind of fever or something like that that made him lame. He was born that way. He'd been that way all of his life. And he heard what Paul was speaking. Now, the next thing you have on your outline is Paul healed the man. Paul not only spoke, but he healed the man. Now, evidently, the man was well known throughout the city. He had lived there all of his life. That was his hometown. People knew him. He heard what Paul had said and believed what Paul had declared about the power of Jesus, the Son of God. The Word of God produced faith in the Son of God. Isn't that what it says in Romans chapter 10, verse 17? Faith comes through hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Or in the NIV, it says faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. You see, faith is emphasized as a condition of receiving both physical and spiritual healing, and that faith is strengthened through the word of God. These miracles didn't happen without first the word of God. And faith is emphasized as a condition for both physical and spiritual healing. Now, the evidence that the man had faith was made plain really by his ready obedience to Paul's command. What did Paul tell him? Paul tells him, stand up on your feet. Well, if the man didn't have faith, would he have obeyed that? He's been lame his whole life. The man had never walked in his whole life. He had no idea what it was like to walk. Paul said, stand up. And the man had faith enough to try. And it says, at that, the man jumped up and began to walk. Why? Well, he believed the message. He believed, first of all, what Paul was saying about Jesus Christ. He believed the message. He heard the word and believed. And it says that Paul saw that he had faith to be healed. Now, that was probably some kind of supernatural direction that the Holy Spirit had put into his mind. But there was something, as Paul saw in this man, he had faith, that he had believed. And on the basis of that man's faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, Paul gave that command, stand up and walk, and the man jumped up and began to walk. You go back to chapter 3 where Peter and John healed the lame man at the temple. It's interesting. It says, the man, there's a kid's song. The man began to jump. He leaped and walked and praised God. Well, this man who had never walked, he didn't just stand up like I would. You know, as you get older, getting out of furniture is a challenge sometimes. You ever sit in a sofa too long and then try to get up and you're kind of like rolling around and finally get up on your feet? He said he jumped up. He never walked. He jumps up and begins to walk. Didn't say he ran and leaped like it does in Acts chapter 3, but he jumped up and he began to walk. You know, that's the way the Christian life works. You know, it doesn't make any difference whether the problem is physical, emotional, or spiritual. You're going to be held in bondage until you begin by faith to obey the word of God about it. We have to be like the lame man. We have to believe. We have to hear the word. We have to believe. When you make the effort to obey the word of God, God will set you free. But he will never move until you obey what he has to say. That's the way faith works. We have to obey. You may be kept from seeing God at work in your life because you just keep waiting for him to do something. But he's already done all that he's going to do for you through the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, when Jesus died on the cross, was buried, and rose again, God did everything that he's going to do for you, and you need to believe in him and obey his word. It's already done. All we do need to do is receive it. It's done through the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you believe what he says, then he will give you the power to be free. You can be set free from your disability through faith and obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ. We fail to see God at work so many times in our lives because we fail to live in obedience to his word. This man had a disability. This man needed a healing. And Paul did that. Paul told him, stand up and walk. Now, God had given to the apostles that apostolic authority and gifting where they could do those kind of miraculous things. But understand, God has promised in his word He tells us for the church in the book of James that if any of you are sick, let them call for the elders of the church, and let the elders of the church anoint you with oil and pray for you, and the prayer offered in faith will heal the sick. I ask you this morning, do you believe that? If you don't do that, you don't believe that. And if you don't believe that, you will never see the power of God at work in your life. It's been done at the cross. Through the cross, Jesus suffered and died in our place, so that we may be healed. It says, by his stripes we are healed. Which is not just eternal life. Friends, it's obedience to his word. If Paul would have told that guy, stand up and walk, and the guy would have said, well, let me think about it. I need to go to my therapist. We need to obey God and trust him and understand his will. It was God's will for this man to be healed and to be delivered. Because when that happened, it set the whole city in an uproar. The miracle cracked the city wide open. The whole population immediately responded to the presence of Paul and Barnabas in their midst. Number two in your outline is the homage, H-O-M-A-G-E. I know what it is, you know what it is. I'm not saying it right. The homage paid to Paul and Barnabas. That's in verses 11 through 13. You know, this was a superstitious crowd, and they interpreted these events in light of their own mythology. They identified Barnabas as Zeus, the chief of the gods, and Paul, the speaker. They identified him with Hermes. That was the messenger of the gods. And so you have, first of all, the worship there from the local people. The two gods, when the Greeks knew as Zeus and Hermes, the mythology there, the legend was that they had come down and visited that area in the likeness of men. And according to the legend, Zeus and Hermes came looking for lodging, you know, as men. And they asked about 1,000 homes, you know, for lodging, for hospitality. But no one would take them in. Now, would you take in two strangers coming to your house and looking for some lodging? But finally, at a humble cottage, an elderly couple, the names are Philemon and Basius, welcomed them in and then went kind of overboard in showing them hospitality. And so in appreciation, the gods rewarded their hospitality, according to the legend. And then Zeus and Hermes destroyed the homes of the 1,000 people that didn't welcome them. That was the local legends. And so it appears that seeing the healing of the crippled man, somebody that had been lame from birth, and if they were lame from birth, they were a beggar in town, the people of Lystra believed that Zeus and Hermes had returned, and they wanted to pay homage lest they incur God's wrath. Well, we need to worship these guys because nobody else could ever heal a man like this. This must be the gods. Well, it was God. It wasn't the God, their gods. But imagine going into a city that's strange, unknown. They had never been there before. And they are being welcomed as gods. Now, it took a long time when we got married for my wife to be convinced that I wasn't like that. Amen.
But understand, this was an attack of Satan. And so you have on there, I think on your outline, the warfare from the enemy. The enemy was appealing to the egos of Paul and Barnabas. You imagine? They're going to worship these guys as gods. They're successful. They've had a successful ministry already. And so it was a chance for the apostles really to take over the city, really on their own terms. Who's going to stand in opposition to them? If they were afraid that Hermes and Zeus would destroy them, then they're going to give everything they want, everything they could to Paul and Barnabas, because they healed this lame man. You know, they could maybe call down fire and destroy the rest of the town. Understand, that's the original sin of Satan. Satan fell from heaven because he wanted to be God. And Satan took that, his original sin, and he brought it to the Garden of Eden. Remember what he told Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden? Well, you don't have to listen to what God said. After all, he's just interested in preserving his own authority. If you take and bite from the fruit of that tree he's told you not to eat, you are going to be like God. And Adam and Eve were like, we could be large and in charge. And so Paul and Barnabas was being tested by their success, tested to use the power of God for personal glory and self-promotion. That's why the Apostle Paul would write in Romans, "Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the measure of faith God has given you." Don't think of yourself more highly than you ought. Proverbs 16:18 says, "Pride goes before what? A fall." We don't want the term fallen after your name, right? Pride goes before a fall. A haughty spirit before a fall. Once Paul and Barnabas recognized what was going on, I understand that they shouted in the Lyconian language. It says in verse 11, I'm not sure Paul and Barnabas understood the Lyconian language. They understood Greek. They understood Hebrew. These people were speaking a language they weren't familiar with. They didn't go to language school before they went on this missions trip like our missionaries do. So it took them, I think, a little while, but it's because it says in verse 14, when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard this, they tore their clothes. It's like there's an element there. They took a while to figure out what was going on, but once they figured it out, number three on your outline is the humility of Paul and Barnabas. See, the first thing they did was protest. They tore their clothes. Now, tearing their clothes was really to express their grief and horror over the actions of the people. They were horrified about what the people were about to do in worshiping them, paying homage to them. And so they rushed out into the crowd, protesting the crowd's intentions and really insisting, we're just humans like everyone else. We're not gods. We're not Zeus. We're not Hermes. We're just like everybody else. But then they preached. That's in verses 15 through 18. It's interesting. It says, they preached. They were shouting. And it's plural. We. Now, we don't know if that's the message Paul gave or they did it in stereo, but it came out that way. There's the message. It's a pattern for proclaiming the gospel to non-religious people. You want to know how to reach your neighbors who are not interested in the gospel? You want to know how to talk to people who know nothing about the scripture, who have not been to church, maybe not even interested in it? Well, here's the way the Apostle Paul spoke to these people. When Paul went to the Jews, where did he go? He went first to the synagogue, right? And in the synagogue, he spoke from the scriptures because they understood the scriptures. They understood that the scriptures contained the truth about God, something they already knew. But when Paul went to the Greeks, when he went to the Gentiles, he started really with nature. He spoke the truth of God where that they could identify with. And so Paul varied his approach. He varied his methodology, but the message never changed. You see, that's something that's important for us to remember, even as a church, that methods of sharing the gospel change. Sharing the gospel today is not like it was in 1950 or 1960 or 1970 or 2010. It's a different time. Our methods need to change, but the message stays the same. Everywhere Paul went, the methodology was a little bit different according to the people he addressed. But you'll notice the message never changed. It's called the Word of God, the message of salvation, the message of His grace, or as it says here, the good news. That's the gospel. He never changes the message. Paul says three things about God. He wanted to show these people that God was totally different from their worthless legends and their idols. And so he pointed them to the true and living God and ultimately to Jesus as their Savior. There's three things. Number one, he says that God is the living God. That's in verse 15. The idols and gods they worshiped were not living. They were just images of stone and wood. The gods they worshiped were myths, legends. God is always alive and active. God is always alive and active on earth. He's the living God. That's where Paul starts. I want to tell you about the living God. And number two, that God is the creator of all things. That's in verse 15. The Greeks and the Romans believed the myth of creation of the world by their God. Their God was called Chaos. Sounds like something from James Bond or something out of Inspector Gadget. He was always fighting chaos or whatever. But that's the Greeks and Romans believed in a creation by a God called Chaos, which means, now, doesn't make sense. Look at the world even today. Doesn't it seem chaotic? And so if a God created the world, well, the God had to be chaos. But he also tells them, number three, that God is good. That's in verses 16 and 17. God's a giving God. God is good. All the time? Oh, we can do that better, right? I hope you believe that. God is good.
All the time?
God is good. And that's what Paul tells them, that God is good. Their gods were just advanced humans with limited powers, and they were subject to the same sins and failures as humanity. You know, read the ancient legends and the myths about the Greek and the Roman gods. They were selfish, carnal, you know, cruel and vindictive. They were proud and selfish, arrogant gods. They committed the worst possible evils and atrocities against each other, but also against mankind. And so when Paul says that God is good, it's in stark contrast to how they saw their gods. He says that the true God is in control of all things. In his dealings with humanity, he's always good, kind, merciful, and loving. And he does those things so that we can know, first of all, that there is a God, but that we also will turn to him in salvation. The goodness of God, Paul would say, leads us to repentance. The goodness and the kindness of God ought to be drawing us to a place of repentance where we want to turn to him. We can love him and have a real and personal relationship with him because he's a living God. Not simply appease the gods out of fear, but we can come to him because he's good and he loves us. So when we have an opportunity to share the gospel, we have to begin where people are. We need to find a point of contact with people. So the methodology changes, but the message stays the same. No matter where we begin, we always end up with Jesus Christ. Somebody said that about A.B. Simpson, who God used to start the whole movement called the Christian Missionary Alliance, that whenever they heard A.B. Simpson preach, it didn't matter what text, didn't matter what the theme of his message was, there was one thing that always happened. He always ended with Jesus. And that's the way we need to do. Because he alone is the good, good God. He is the only one who can set us free. Free from sin and shame, free from, like we sang when the old rugged cross, free from our sin, free from disabilities through faith and obedience in Jesus Christ. Paul and Barnabas' response was a response of humility. Philippians 2:3, Paul wrote, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit." Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourself. We're just human beings. Let me point you to God. God condemns human pride. God condemns that human pride because it's opposed to him. That means we are unwilling to submit to him. God despises those who are filled with haughtiness and who boast in their own self-confidence and self-conceit. He opposes the proud. But what does he do for the humble? He gives grace. 1 Corinthians 1:31, Paul wrote, "Let the one who boasts boast in the Lord." That's what Paul and Barnabas did. They directed the attention away from themselves and pointed the people towards God. Our character, I believe, is tested by the praise that comes to us. Every praise that comes to our ears should ultimately redound to the glory of God. If we hold on to it, if you hold on to the praise that you receive from humans, if that's what you're looking for, understand that it infects your heart. Humility comes when we pass the praise up to God. When you receive a praise or a compliment, simply say, "Thank you." Do your Elvis. "Thank you. Thank you very much." But that's what we got to do. Just say, "Thank you. Thank you very much." And then thank God. And then thank the Lord for the blessing. Thank the Lord for... Because you want to recognize that anything worthy of praise ultimately comes from him. Paul and Barnabas were directing people to God because ultimately they didn't do anything. It was God that healed that man. It was God that gave him faith. And so they directed attention towards Jesus. Number 4 is the attempted homicide of Paul. Verses 19 and 20. You see, the first attack of the enemy was to pump Paul and Barnabas up with pride. And Satan's like, "Well, if I can get them to accept this praise, if I can get them to accept this worship of themselves, then you know, I'm going to shut down this missionary tour. I'm going to shut down the spread of the gospel, because they're just going to stay here and soak it in and abuse these people in whatever way that they can." But it failed. Because they responded in humility and passed the praise on to the Lord. Well, Satan wasn't done. As soon as the power of the gospel is unleashed, Satan strikes back. And his temptation with pride failed, so now he falls back on his old standard. You know what his old standard is? Is violence. You know what? Probably the the second sin after the Garden of Eden that's recorded for us in the Bible is? Come on.
Murder.
Cain and Abel. See, Satan wants to puff up your pride, and then the next thing is violence. It's murder. And that's what they tried to do to Paul and Barnabas. He was, first of all, rejected. You know, troublemaking Jews arrived from Antioch and Iconium. They must have been hot on his trail. We're not told how long they were there, but they followed, the crowd followed their lead and stoned Paul. You know, hard, sharp rocks cut his body and bruised and crushed him, left him lying in a crumpled heap on the pavement. Understand, this was not an execution. This was not a legally performed execution. We would say in our terminology, it was more like a lynching. They just took matters into their own hands and stoned Paul. But, you know, here, just think of this. 1 minute, Paul was a god to be worshipped, right? And the next minute, he's a criminal to be executed. Who else was like that? Come on. Jesus. What happened on the day of the triumphant entry? The whole city was like, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And by Friday, they were saying, execute him. We don't want this man anymore. Give us Barabbas. And now Paul's experiencing the same thing. His enemies dragged him outside the city gates, threw him on the city garbage dump, and they thought, we've done away with this guy. They thought he was dead. But God wasn't finished. Paul was not only rejected, but he was restored. This is the only stoning that Paul ever experienced. He says that in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. But from this stoning, God was glorified because God restored him. It says the disciples. Now understand, these are newborn believers. These aren't people that have been Christians and walking with Jesus for years and years. These were people that had newborn, they were newborn Christians. They had newborn faith. You know, a lot of times newborn Christians have a lot more faith than some of us that have been around for 20 or 30 years. Because they just, if God said it, I believe it, let's do it. They gathered around Paul, along with Barnabas. We're not told exactly what they did, but it says they gathered around him. Well, I think they joined together in this moment of crisis, and I think they did what any of us would probably do. They prayed. And look at what it says. After the disciples had gathered around him, he got up. Who does that sound like? Sounds like this dude back here that says, the man jumped up and began to walk. They gathered around him and prayed, and the man who the people thought was dead got up. He was restored. God raised him up. They thought he was dead. Now, people ask, well, did Paul die? Most Bible commentators believe that, well, he wasn't dead, he was unconscious, because Luke, writing here in the book of Acts, says they thought he was dead. Other people say, well, he did die, but ultimately God has the final say and restored him. So they thought he was dead. Yeah, they thought he was dead, but God is the one who has the final say. 2 Corinthians 4:9, Paul would write, I am struck down, but not destroyed. It can also be translated, we may be knocked down, but we are never knocked out. Paul was struck down, but not destroyed. He was resilient. This morning we were watching a preacher on TV, and he this was sermons from years ago, but he used some old King James words, and Jenny stopped the video, stopped it and said, why do preachers always do that? They use words that we don't understand. And so when I thought about that, I came over here this morning and I wrote on in my margin here, resilient. What does that mean? It means flexible, an ability to be stretched. And so Paul was resilient, he was flexible, he had the ability to be stretched in his faith. He was knocked down, but not destroyed. You can put another word by that. You can write the word courageous. I mean, we talked about that, what, last week? Look at what he did. He got up and ran for his life. He went back into the city. It's like, Paul, what are you thinking? They just stoned you to the point where they thought you were dead, and you're going back there? Well, he did. He went back there. The next day, he and Barnabas left for Derbe. Paul remained on mission. He was steadfast, not defeated by the adulation or the opposition of men. So, when you live your life on mission for Jesus Christ, you will face challenges from the people that you're ministering to. And understand that we are all ministers. People call me a minister. Well, yeah, I'm a minister, but you're a minister too. There are people that God has put around you that you have been given to minister to. You are all ministers. And so you're going to face challenges from the people that you're ministering to. Conflict from the enemies of the cross. Especially when you're successfully seeing God work, when transformation is taking place, the enemy is not going to like that. So how will you handle success when you are on mission for Jesus Christ? Well, you got to begin through faith to believe and obey the word of God. There's an old song, trust and obey, right? For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And secondly, when we're tempted through pride, we need to respond with humility. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. James 4:10 says, humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. All praise and honor and worship belongs to Jesus. No, I don't know that you do it. You've been Christians a long time, and you've had good pastors here. You know, don't ever put me or any other pastor up on a pedestal. You're going to be disappointed because I'm going to make mistakes. There's going to be times of disappointment, but not failure, not a fallenness. At least you need to pray for that way. Because the same way Paul was attacked, Satan attacks me, he'll attack you the same way. Praise and honor and worship belongs to Jesus. He's the living God. He's the creator of all things. And he's the one that's good.
All the time.
So when tempted through pride, respond with humility. When faced with hostility, you got to be resilient. You got to be like Paul. You got to be resilient. You heard the phrase, you got to roll with the punches. You'd be knocked down, but not knocked out. Be resilient. Get back up. Go back into the city. You can't get rid of me that quick. You're on mission for Jesus. I kind of got off track in a couple of those points. But I want you to know, when you're on mission for Jesus, you know, we hear about these big name people falling. Well, it happens to the average people in the pew as well. I think, take your hymnal. We're going to end the service this way. And let's find trust and obey. And let's just sing a verse of that. 5:46.